Slow it down, then we're gonna speed it up at the end. Here we go. We're gonna stay on that waistline today.
Every day, like
come on,
first day.
Rock with
me.
Crazy, 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 cr
finish, we're gonna slow it down just a little bit. Y'all ready? Let's go. We're slowing it back down, then we're speeding up. Let's finish it. Come on. We're gonna get those abs. Crunch it.
Bravo, thank you. We see all the comments. John, they want to bottle your energy. But hey, every Tuesday he is here with us, getting you motivated, activated, and enthusiastic about working out. Okay? All right, so Dr. Parker's joined us. But Dr. Parker, I wanted to show the video about exercise really quick. The 3-minute mini TED talk, because we have some newcomers, we have some people that have come many, many times, and we talk about neuroprotective, but this video is so succinct at reminding people how exercise benefits them. So we'll talk about that, and then I'm going to turn the program over to Dr. Parker, and she's going to tell you what we have in store today.
Is the most transformative thing that you can do for your brain today. Number one, it has immediate effects on your brain. A single workout that you do will immediately increase levels of neurotransmitters like dopamine, serotonin, and noradrenaline. My lab showed that a single workout can improve your ability to shift and focus attention, and that focus improvement will last for at least 2 hours. And finally, studies have shown that a single workout will improve your reaction times. Number two, the most common finding in neuroscience studies looking at the effects of exercise, long-term exercise, is improved attention function dependent on your prefrontal cortex. You not only get better focus and attention, but the volume of the hippocampus increases as well. The most transformative thing that exercise will do is its protective effects on your brain. Here you can think about the brain like a muscle. The more you're working out, the bigger and stronger your hippocampus and prefrontal cortex gets. Why is that important? Because the prefrontal cortex and the hippocampus are the two areas that are most susceptible to neurodegenerative diseases and normal cognitive decline in aging. So with increased exercise over your lifetime, you're not going to cure dementia or Alzheimer's disease. But what you're going to do is you're going to create the strongest, biggest hippocampus and prefrontal cortex. So it takes longer for these diseases to actually have an effect. Good news, you don't have to become a triathlete to get these effects. The rule of thumb is you want to get 3 to 4 times a week exercise minimum 30 minutes an exercise session, and you want to get aerobic exercise in. That is, get your heart rate up. Bringing exercise in your life will not only give you a happier and more productive life today, but it will protect your brain from incurable diseases. And in this way, it will change the trajectory of your life for the better.
Thank you, Cornelia, and I really hope everybody understands why we have John Lewis up here shaking around, making us happy and giving us some loud noise and music. So the objective is to make you get up and do some movement. Many of us, as we've been told, don't get any exercise during the week except for what John Lewis gives us as part of our workout. Please understand that here at the Goizueta Alzheimer's Disease Research Center, yes, we do Alzheimer's research, and the Alzheimer's part of Alzheimer's research is preventing the disease. Exercise and anything you can do to keep both your body and your mind healthy are things that protect you against the development of Alzheimer's. Our speaker today, Dr. Lenora Higginbotham, is a neurologist who specializes in movement disorders. She is in an area of research. I'm going to say it wrong, but it's proteomics, and she's going to be doing more about what we can do to help, how our brain can help predict whether or not we're going to get Alzheimer's. Alzheimer's and other disorders. I think I got that right. I tried to make it simple for our audience, Lenora, but in any event, here is Dr. Lenora Higginbotham, one of our movement disorders neurologists. I think she's brilliant because I claim credit for her. She is trained at both Yale, Johns Hopkins, and now us, Dr. Higginbotham.
All right, thank you so much, Monica, for that introduction. I'm gonna share my screen here. I'm actually not talking a whole lot about Alzheimer's today, but I am talking about cognitive disorders and Parkinsonism and how we're studying them with EEG biomarkers. So let me just get my screen shown here, and hopefully everybody can see that okay. Get my pointer here. Okay. So again, thanks again for the introduction. I'm Lenora Higginbotham. I'm a movement disorders physician. The movement disorders division is very closely aligned with the cognitive group here. We actually see some of the same patients. It's just that the majority of our patients tend to have neurodegenerative diseases with prominent motor components. And the most common one we see is Parkinson's disease. And actually today I'm gonna represent a center that we have kind of almost analogous to the Alzheimer's Disease Research Center in the cognitive group. We have a UDAL center, and the UDAL center in general is conducting a study of EEG biomarkers. And I was asked to give a little preview of that study because there is an opportunity for individuals who might be on here without Parkinson's disease to actually join the study. So I was just going to give you a little introduction to how we use EEG biomarkers in Parkinson's disease, how it relates to cognition in Parkinson's disease, and then a study opportunity that some of you may be able to participate in. All right, so some of you may be familiar with Parkinson's disease, but for those who aren't, it is a progressive condition that really affects a variety of pathways and causes motor and non-motor symptoms. I think the motor symptoms are the best well-known, right, and well-described. They're encapsulated here in this cartoon gentleman who's hunched over here, and you'll see these lines that are taking place around his head and hands. This is to indicate that he is shaking, probably one of the best known motor symptoms of Parkinson's disease is rest tremor. This is tremor that comes on when you are just resting. So you're not doing anything, but you'll be shaking, usually in a hand or a leg. However, you have to remember that only 2/3 of Parkinson's disease patients have the tremor. There's actually a full third of patients who do not have this tremor, but they do have Parkinson's disease. And so perhaps more universal to this disease is the slowness and the stiffness that it causes. So if you were to set this gentleman in motion here, you would see that he has small shuffling steps. He moves really slowly. This hunched over posture is typical of the disease. His arms don't swing very much. His face doesn't have much emotion. So it's a slowness of movement, but also an absence of movement. And if you were to move some of his limbs around, they might actually feel stiff. And so the slowness and stiffness is perhaps more universal to Parkinson's disease, plus or minus the rest tremor. And about 2/3 of patients have that rest tremor. And so I'm gonna get to the non-motor symptoms, including cognitive decline in Parkinson's in just a second, because that's what the study is gonna focus on. But first, I wanted to talk about some of the brain abnormalities in Parkinson's disease. So one of the ones you might hear about commonly is accumulation of a protein called alpha-synuclein. This is pretty much akin to the amyloid and tau that accumulates in Alzheimer's disease. It is a protein that is just piling up in the brain where it should not be. This indirectly or directly causes a loss of dopamine generating neurons in the basal ganglia. So neurons, as many of you may know, are the cells that populate the brain and do a lot of the activities in the brain. This is a kind of cartoon picture of neurons, and I like it because they're working together, which is critical to the study that I'm talking about today. But essentially in the basal ganglia, which is in the deep parts of your brain, is just made up of these little centers in the brain that are very involved in movement. And one of the key facilitators of that movement is dopamine. And the cells that generate dopamine in the basal ganglia are actually dying away to some extent in Parkinson's. So that's going on too. But actually, I'm probably spend more time on today is the remaining cells in the brain. So you have these cells that are degenerating in the basal ganglia. You are losing these cells in Parkinson's disease. But then there are these remaining cells left, not only in the basal ganglia, but all the way out to the cortex. So the cortex, for those of you who don't know, is on the outer portion of the brain. So again, the basal ganglia is on the inner portion. The cortex is on the outer portion, and they communicate with each other. And what's happening in Parkinson's disease, what we found is that there are all kinds of abnormal firing patterns that are emitted in the neurons that are left, not only in the basal ganglia, but in its connections to the cortex as well, particularly the motor cortex, which sits on the outer portion of the brain. And again, that's what we're going to focus on is actually how do we measure and how can we use those abnormal firing patterns that are in those neurons that are left, right? What do they tell us about disease? So one question you might be asking, well, why are those neurons firing abnormally? Well, I think it's best to think about a neuron not individually, but as a set, because neurons, each neuronal cell in the brain has its own precise individual firing pattern. But really, it's the synchrony of all the neurons that really control a lot of functions. So each neuron is usually not operating in isolation. And if you disrupt some of those neurons or some of those neurons are degenerating, it's easy to kind of fathom how the remaining neurons would become asynchronous or develop abnormal patterns of synchrony. And that's what we're trying to channel and study, right? I tend to like describe this to patients as just to hammer it in as a synchronized swimming team, right? Like if you take away one or one of them is just doing their own thing, then it kind of messes up the pattern, right? And so by studying these synchronous neuronal firing in Parkinson's, we have learned that the abnormalities in that synchrony, in that firing pattern that we can measure actually correlate really well with motor symptoms and perhaps drive motor symptoms, actually. So how do we study and detect these firing abnormalities? So some of you may have had this study before. It's called an EEG or electroencephalogram. And essentially there's many ways of performing an EEG. You can do it more invasively where people actually, this is more rare. This is more for epilepsy cases, seizure cases, where they actually put electrodes in the brain. But for a lot of the EEGs that we perform, we can actually measure brain waves and synchronous neuronal firing patterns through the skull using special electrodes that we place on the scalp. And for those of you who have had it, you may know either you might have had a cap placed on your head with these electrodes on there. You might have had the electrodes specifically pasted to your scalp. But essentially, these electrodes are placed on the scalp and they're hooked up to a machine that actually measures your brain waves. And those brain waves are a representation of those firing patterns of synchronous neurons in the brain. It's almost like people who got an EKG, right? When you get your heart waves measured, essentially. Kind of easy to think about. You just put those little stickers on and it measures the heart waves. It's a similar thing with the brain. And those neurons are always firing. Like even when you sleep, they may change different patterns. They're always firing. So a lot of times, every time we get an EEG, we can usually learn about the firing rates in your brain, something or other. And for those of you who had an EEG, you may not have actually seen this printout, but this is sort of like when we do the clinical EEGs, like in the hospital or in the clinic, we get a printout of your brain waves and it looks basically like this. Every single electrode will have its own little brain wave. And there are big patterns that we can actually analyze just from visually looking at these. But a lot of the research that we do for these like EEG biomarkers that we are measuring actually comes from processing these waves again through software and things like that, that really breaks them down. So nothing that you would actually necessarily be able to see visually, we would just put all of this kind of gross data or like this big picture data, we put through another algorithm and we can get very, very precise in different metrics that I won't go into today. But the point is that this kind of EEG output can tell us a lot about how your brain is firing. We can see general patterns of abnormality, which is kind of what we use in the clinic, but in the research setting, particularly in Parkinson's disease, we can put that information, those brain waves, through even more algorithms and even more software to really pull out really specific and nuanced data. And so what we have determined from doing these types of research studies is that these specific abnormal firing patterns that we see in Parkinson's disease that we can actually pull out with algorithms, they actually disappear when Parkinson's patients take dopamine replacement. Remember how I told you that dopamine is generating neurons are being lost in the Parkinson's brain? Well, one way we treat those is we give a medicine that replaces the dopamine. And what we have seen is that Parkinson's patients, when they're not taking this dopamine replacement, they'll have these abnormal firing rates. But then when they take it and their motor symptoms improve, and the medication can be very effective to improve motor symptoms, we see improvement in these brain waves or suppression of these brain waves or normalization of these brain waves. And so what we've come to conclude is that there are actual measured EEG biomarkers that we can measure non-invasively in Parkinson's patients that really correlate well to motor symptoms. And when those motor symptoms are gone, they disappear, which is really cool. How do we use that though? How do we use that? So one way we've used that in Parkinson's disease is really to advance certain treatments, particularly the treatment known as deep brain stimulation. Now, this is not used as commonly in cognitive disorders. There's not an FDA-approved deep brain stimulation treatment for things like Alzheimer's and certain dementias. But Parkinson's disease has had deep brain stimulation approved since 1997 for its motor symptoms. Okay? And what that is, for those of you who are not familiar with deep brain stimulation, it's actually the process of putting a very tiny electrode that can emit electricity and stimulation into the very inner part of the brain called the basal ganglia, which I mentioned earlier, which is abnormal in Parkinson's disease. And then that electrode comes out. It's not outside of the body or anything. It is all internalized. But just for, so you can see it here, it's like they've opened it up for you. So that electrode comes out, stays underneath the scalp, but is connected to a wire or a lead extension that goes down to a battery inside your chest. And how we often use deep brain stimulation is to help with motor symptoms. When the levodopa, or which is the dopamine replacement we use, may not necessarily be as helping the patient as much as their disease progresses, we turn to deep brain stimulation, which can often help tremor, slowness, and stiffness, and really improve motor symptoms. But now what we've learned, right, is that we have these markers that we can actually follow in the brain. So not only are we providing stimulation, but we can actually sense your actual brain waves with these electrodes. And what they're working towards now are deep brain stimulation devices that actually program themselves. So they detect when you have tremor from these abnormal brain waves, and they can adjust the stimulation accordingly. That is what they're working towards. So they don't do that yet. Some of you guys who may be familiar with deep brain stimulation may know that right now the doctors are like, you would see me in clinic and I would give you a specific setting. And I kind of judge based on your symptom control where your setting should be. But because we have learned so much about these EEG biomarkers, we are improving these devices so that they'll get better and better and maybe not need as much of the human presence like me guiding programming, which is interesting to think about, maybe even a little scary to think about, but it's really neat that they are able to use these EEG biomarkers to improve the treatment of Parkinson's patients. So that's just one example of how we're using them. Now, let me get into just a little bit of the study that we're doing. So now you've seen that, you know, EEG biomarkers can really advance treatment, and we can measure them in certain ways and they correlate with certain symptoms. But I've been telling you mostly about motor symptoms. I have not mentioned anything about non-motor symptoms in Parkinson's, which there are many. And one of those is thinking and memory problems or cognitive problems. And we actually know very, very little about how abnormal firing influences or is correlated to non-motor symptoms in the Parkinson's brain. We've done all of this research with motor symptoms, and we've learned a lot about motor symptoms and EEG biomarkers, but not non-motor symptoms. And so I'm just going to give you a brief introduction to particularly the thinking and memory problems that you can see in Parkinson's. Because I feel like Parkinson's is, yes, it's considered a movement disorder, but there are so many non-motor symptoms that can be debilitating, from anxiety, depression, to constipation, to loss of sense of smell, to dream enactment at night, acting your dreams out at night. And then another big one is thinking and memory. So Parkinson's patients, after they've had the disease for a long, long time, are also at increased risk of dementia. But I'm not talking about dementia today. I'm talking about thinking and memory problems that occur throughout Parkinson's disease that are not necessarily up to a dementia level, but can impact a person's day-to-day functioning. And usually they come from disruption of those dopamine tracts, but they don't respond to dopamine. So there's all kinds of things we're learning about the non-motor issues in Parkinson's, but a lot of them do not respond to dopamine. And that's why we don't know as much about stimulation and dopamine, how these things affect non-motor symptoms. But I'm just going to tell you about symptoms that are not necessarily dementia, but affect lots of Parkinson's disease patients throughout their entire lives. And the syndrome that they tend to have throughout the disease is called a dysexecutive syndrome. And many of you have heard a lot about Alzheimer's, might have heard this term before, because Alzheimer's patients, in addition to memory issues, can also have executive problems, which form in the front part of the brain. They just tend to be more prominent in Parkinson's disease. And some of these symptoms that Parkinson's disease patients experience throughout their lives that are due to these frontal symptoms, a dysexecutive syndrome, is trouble with multitasking, organizing, or planning, difficulty switching tasks, deficits in attention or working memory. Working memory is a little bit different from short-term or long-term memory. It is that memory that you just want to hold, and your only intention is to hold it for about 5 minutes at most, maybe even less. Like if I'm working on my computer and someone pops their head in my office and tells me, you know what, I want you to bill that invoice or something for this amount, okay? And they leave, and all I have to do is hold it in my head for about a minute while I go up and pull that program in my computer and pull up that program and open where I'm supposed to bill and then put that number. I just wanted to hold that number in my head for like a minute, maybe less. And that's what Parkinson's patients or people with any dysexecutive syndrome experience problems with. They can't hold that number. So they'll hear that number, then like a minute later, they forget it. That's working memory. You never intended to hold it for any long period of time, just a minute, but it's hard to do. There's also tip of the tongue phenomenon. So you want that word is right there, but it just won't come out, may come out a day later. But that's also part of the dysexecutive syndrome. And then one other big thing that I usually hear about mainly discussed with Parkinson's is difficulty with response inhibition. And this one that sounds the most vague and gray of all of the ones I talked about is actually the one that we are studying. And so what is response inhibition? So it's a frontal syndrome problem. It arises out of dysexecutive function, right? And it allows you to cancel or inhibit responses. So it's like something that allows you whatever you're doing to inhibit that. Or if you have like an urge to do anything, maybe something that you wouldn't normally do, you're able to inhibit yourself in certain situations. A lot of us kind of take that for granted that we just are constantly probably inhibiting ourselves to some extent all the time. But impairment in response inhibition can lead to something called impulsivity, which people are probably familiar with, and compulsion, which can be a big issue in Parkinson's disease. So Parkinson's disease patients can be very prone to being impulsive and developing compulsive behaviors, meaning they're doing something over and over that they don't necessarily want to do, or they would normally not do, that might even be dangerous or not great to do, but they're doing it anyway. And one of the things that makes this such a problem in Parkinson's disease is that the treatments that we give people in Parkinson's, like dopamine replacement, can make that worse. They can actually worse, they improve motor symptoms, but they might actually worsen impulsivity and compulsion. Deep brain stimulation can also worsen that. And one of the reasons, big reasons we wanted to study what these brain waves are doing is because, you know, we want to be able to modify motor symptoms and we want to have good trackers of motor symptoms. But we also want ways of following these detrimental non-motor symptoms. So if we implement DBS, what is it doing to your response inhibition? Is it making it worse? Can we track that somehow? Can we actually detect Parkinson's disease patients that may have worsened response inhibition or impaired response inhibition early in disease, so we know that potential treatments could amplify that, maybe avoid them? You know, there are all different kinds of ways where it'd be great to know if somebody's really, really prone to this issue. And so what we have decided to study is abnormal neuronal firing that underlines impairments in response inhibition in Parkinson's disease. And we're trying to figure out how these impairments, how they affect how our treatments and the disease itself affect response inhibition and these abnormal firing patterns. So that's what we're interested in studying. And I'm getting quite to the end here, but I just wanted to offer, so I don't have a lot to tell you today about abnormal firing patterns and cognition, thinking and memory, but only to tell you that we are studying them in Parkinson's disease. And we are doing this using non-invasive EEG recordings. So like I talked about earlier, in these studies, you're actually going to wear a cap. It has electrodes that you place on the cap or through the cap. So nothing invasive, but you might have to wash your hair after because sometimes the electrodes will stick on and that sometimes that we will get a little bit through the cap. And we're going to measure the EEG while you do two tasks that measure response inhibition. And these two tasks are, you do them on a computer, but one is a go, no go task. So it's just going to show you different squares and patterns of squares. And when you see one pattern, you press this key, and you see another pattern, you press another key. But when you see a certain pattern, you hold, you don't press anything. And people with response inhibition problems will often press when they're not supposed to. And then the modified stop signal task, you're constantly doing a motion and then you'll have to stop. Sometimes the stops are planned, like we'll tell you, you know, you're going to stop in 6 seconds and you stop. But people with some disinhibition might do this easily, but they might do unplanned stops poorly. Maybe when they're hit with like a sudden cue to stop, they have trouble stopping fast enough. So all we're gonna do is measure your brain waves while you do that. And we are comparing healthy controls to Parkinson's disease patients. We actually have quite a few Parkinson's disease patients. So one of the reasons I'm coming here to educate today is tell you a little bit about brain waves, but also if there are any healthy controls listening out there, any spouses of individuals who are interested in participating in research, definitely we want you. The initial part is a phone screening part. So we'll just have our study coordinator take a brief medical history and cognitive screen. We don't want big neurologic disorders actually or psychiatric diagnoses, but we will, it's a little variable. So if you think that if you're not sure about something, but you're interested, please just reach out to us. The screening, we will kind of let you know if it's appropriate or not, if you're appropriate or not to serve as a comparison to a Parkinson's disease patient. The research visits, visit one, you will just get cognitive testing. So you will just get a thinking and memory test, a pretty long one, about a couple of hours. And then the next one will be your EEG recording while performing those tasks that I showed you. And then finally, you have an incentive. You get a $50 gift card. And I was specifically told to say for each visit, that means if you do two visits, you get two gift cards, usually for things like Target and Walmart. So anyway, what we're hoping to do is really clamp down on the non-motor issues in Parkinson's, which we think can be generalizable to other disorders as well. And we are just looking towards the population to help us do this study. And also I hope maybe you learned a little bit today about Parkinson's disease. Thank you.
Okay, well, that was amazing. Wow. One question. Yeah. Okay, go ahead, Dr. Higginbotham.
Oh, no, I forgot to put up the final slide. That's our site board.
Contact information. Yes, that is key and essential. Okay, just a couple of questions from a viewer. They want to know about, like, is there a gel that's applied to your hair or scalp with the EEG?
Yeah, there is. So I actually think this one is a little bit nicer than some of the ones. You might have had one where the electrode is actually directly placed onto the scalp. For the studies that they're doing in the Udall Center, there's usually a cap involved. There is a gel that actually goes through these little holes here, and the electrode is placed in there. And it's the gel that goes through the holes that can get in your hair, yes. So afterwards, a lot of times patients will wipe it down a little bit. You might want to wash your hair afterwards, but it's nothing that sticks in the hair for a long period of time. It's easily washed out after.
Okay. And then will you repeat, who is it? Is it Jonna?
Yeah, it's Jonna. So okay. Jonna Seppa. And again, I think they have mostly the Parkinson patients they need it, but if there's any Parkinson patients that are on here listening, Jonna actually does a ton of Parkinson studies for us involving simulation, so it would not hurt to reach out to her if you're interested in research in general. For this particular study, I think they want more comparison patients to kind of, or subjects to kind of see what's happening in Parkinson's disease, so that can be other healthy control.
Okay, and so I'm going to run down a variety of questions that are frequently asked. How long does the phone screen take?
Oh, yeah, that's a really great question. So I was told it wouldn't take any more than like 15 to 20 minutes. I think the biggest part is the brief cognitive screen is just a few questions. And then the middle medical history is just another few questions. So it's nothing as long as this cognitive testing that you would get with Visit One.
Okay, and then a viewer just asked, are these tests in person and where?
Yeah, so these research visits are done at the Brain Health Center at Emory. So that would have been nice to put up there, I think, but yes, each one is done at the Emory Brain Health Center.
Mm-hmm. And that's in Atlanta, everyone, right off 85 in North Druid Hills. You will have to come on site if you meet the inclusion criteria for the phone screen. Okay, and then what about age limits? Like, you want healthy, normal controls. What's the age limit?
Yeah, so we are looking for patients that really match our Parkinson's patients. So I think the magic number is somewhere between, because you can get Parkinson's actually pretty young. So between 40 and 75. Upwards of 80. There's not a hard, as far as I understand, there's not like a hard cutoff, but between that realm, 40 to 75.
And then, so, are you going to share the results of the EEG with participants? Like, that's an incentive to participate.
Right? Yeah, I think it is. So definitely we are, so I actually went to a lecture of the Udall last night, and so one of the study coordinators who's really doing a lot of the EEG visits, they've already gotten some preliminary data from the Parkinson's patients that suggests that on medications, levodopa, the dopamine replacement actually does worsen the response inhibition on those tasks. So we're already seeing some changes within the Parkinson's disease population. We just we haven't controlled them. We haven't compared them a lot to controls yet. So as that data comes out, definitely we have a list of participants and we can share some of those general results with you. The big question that comes up that maybe some of you are actually concerned about, and we've discussed multiple times, is if we see a problem on the neurocognitive testing, you know, if we think actually you might have some impairments that you might want to see somebody about, or some things that we were not anticipated on the phone screen. The neuropsychologist who is actually performing the cognitive testing, Felicia Goldstein, has agreed to have sessions with people, educational sessions, to let them know a little bit about those deficits and ultimately how to get them checked out. So we, if we do find something that we weren't anticipating on the cognitive screening, we will tell you.
Right. And that's required. So again, if, once you sign that consent form, the study coordinators will go through all of the ins and outs with the study so you have a clear understanding of, you know, what you're committing to and what you can expect for the study. Okay, a few more questions. What about if someone's on like a neurologic or psychiatric medication? Is that part of an exclusion criteria?
Yeah, so I've talked to definitely Dr. Myasinovic, who's doing this study with us, and it a little bit depends. We've gone a little bit back and forth on antidepressants and things like that, but definitely certain neurologic medications that indicate there's another disease process going on. We don't necessarily are not including those. Most of those people will get excluded. So if you're on a specific type of neurologic medication, particularly for a diagnosis. But antidepressants, I would definitely, if you're interested, just reach out. Psychotic disorders or antipsychotics, for instance, I think would be more of a hard stop.
Okay, and Ms. Barbara, I saw you had your hand raised. So if you have a question, if you can post it in the Q&A or the chat. And then the other, there's no drugs involved, right?
No drugs. No drugs. Yeah. For the Parkinson's patient, yes, we are doing them on and off the dopamine replacement. But for these purposes, because I figured today would be mostly patients without Parkinson's disease, there are no drugs in the study whatsoever.
Right. And do you know how many people you are looking for?
About 40.
40. Yeah, okay. We have 160 people on today. You heard straight from the doctor's mouth about how to get involved. And I would love for you all to just overwhelm Jonna with inquiries about how to get involved. You just send an email. And Dr. Higginbotham, will you repeat her email live for everyone?
Let me just put that. I think somebody else posted about the age criteria again, about we're looking for ages 40 to 75, but not a hard cutoff because we have some older Parkinson's patients too, so you could potentially match your age.
Yeah, I'm gonna tell you the best thing to do is just send a quick email and say I'm interested so that Jonna can get you scheduled. That's the only way we're gonna be able to help our UDAL Center and get this quota, I'll say, filled for the healthy controls. It sounds like, you know, because the movement disorders clinic is one of the largest ones in the country, they fulfill their requirement for the participants that have Parkinson's, but they need people who are healthy. We're not just studying this in people who have the disease. We want to see how it manifests for people who are healthy, and they want to be able to compare those results, okay? Let's see. Thank you for your presentation. Dr. Higginbotham is 82 too old.
No. I really urge you, like, age-wise, if you're interested, to just reach out to Jonna, because, again, they gave me a age limit, but I don't think those are hard and fast. If they have somebody they can match your age to.
All right.
Yeah. And again, if you have Parkinson's disease and you're on here, do not be discouraged. We have a lot of other studies going on. You can always reach out to Jonna.
Again, thank you so much, Dr. Higginbotham. We learned so much today. Who knew, you know, EEG was available just to study brainwaves and understand how the brain is functioning. So we applaud the Movement Disorder Center and you and all of your work. Thank you, and you're always welcome back to BrainTalk Live, so you'll look out for more invitations. And with that, I'm going to invite Matt to come on and tell us what we can anticipate for CEP Live today.
Hey, everyone. So today we're going to be joined by Greg LaForte. He is one of our great dietitians on the CEP team, so we're going to be talking about nutrition and things that are, you know, things that are good for your heart, is good for your brain, and And we're going to be covering a few different topics today, and hope to see you all there. I'm going to post a link to register for our event in chat. It's going to be happening in just one more minute, and hope to see you there.
Thank you, Matt. All right, so we talked about exercise today. We talked about a possible opportunity for healthy controls to participate in research. And then you can head over to the CEP to join them to learn about nutrition from a dietitian. All right? So once again, thanks for joining us. We will see you back here next Tuesday at 2 p.m. Eastern, whether you're on vacation or joining us. Remember, we're always live on Tuesday at 2 p.m. and you can visit the YouTube channel to see any of the recordings. This will be posted hopefully by the end of the week, if not, no later than Monday, all right? So you can go back and review it. But hey, overwhelm Jonna with some email inboxes, flood her inbox with requests about this opportunity. And we look forward to seeing you back here next week, and have a great rest of the week. Goodbye.